for coming tonight. We're going to get started. I want to thank you for being here this evening. I'm Gwyneth Mallon. I'm the director of the NYU Center for the Humanities, and I'm very pleased to welcome you here tonight. I want to thank our staff, Caroline Osi and Denny Valentin, and our student assistants, Soraya Bunker and Janina Soriano, for their help with tonight's event. And I want to mention our faculty director, Uli Baer, who's here this evening as well. I also want to thank the Arthur L. Carter Journalism Institute for co-sponsoring tonight's event with us, especially Perry Klass and Andrea Calderese. Tonight, we have a very special event for you. When we learned about Stephen Solomon's recent book, Revolutionary Dissent, How the Founding Generation Created the Freedom of Speech, we wanted to feature his book in an event at our center. In this book, Solomon explores through a series of chronological narratives how Americans of the revolutionary period employed robust speech against the British and against each other. Uninhibited dissent provided a distinctly American meaning to the First Amendment's guarantees of freedom of speech and of press at a time when the legal doctrine inherited from England allowed persecutions and prosecutions of those who criticized the government. We have that book on sale for you tonight. What happened, though, was that as Steve and I began to plan this evening's panel, the national political landscape started to change. And once the date was set for 1 month after the inauguration of Donald Trump, we moved the focus of the conversation more towards the threats posed to free speech and to the press by the new administration. Okay, that's popular. We will still have an opportunity to talk about the historical context tonight. We don't want to overlook that. But the panel will also focus on the contemporary challenges. To do so, we will hear from three legal experts, and they are also scholars of the First Amendment. And Stephen will be moderating. I'm going to very briefly introduce everyone and then turn the evening over to Steve. And we will be sure to have question time for all of you at the end as well. Before I do the introductions, I just want to say one personal note, which is that I keep a copy of Eric Foner's Give Me Liberty handy at all times, and last night I consulted it so that we could see the actual language of the First Amendment and have that fresh in our minds for tonight's conversation. I checked with our panelists and they approved it would be a good idea for me to read this short and very important First Amendment to you. The First Amendment. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press, or the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. So that's the text we're thinking about a lot tonight, and now I will introduce our panelists. Oh, I wanted to add that I've shortened these quite a bit. Floyd Abrams is a senior counsel at Cahill, Gordon, Reindel, LLP, and has been a leading attorney in the First Amendment area for the past half century. He has appeared frequently in the Supreme Court in cases ranging from the Pentagon Papers case to the Citizens United case. His forthcoming book, to be published in April by Yale University Press, is entitled The Soul of the First Amendment. George Freeman stepped in to replace Nadine Strothman on short notice tonight. We're very glad he could be here. He will have to leave at 7. George Freeman is an executive director of the Media Law Resource Center, a trade association which supports the media and legal matters, putting on conferences, publishing daily, monthly, and quarterly newsletters and reports, running 18 committees in different substantive areas, and working on policy initiatives. For 31 years, George was the inside First Amendment counsel of the New York Times Company, and he left in 2012 as Vice President and Assistant General Counsel. He is the William J. Brennan Visiting Professor at Columbia Journalism School, and he also teaches at CUNY's Graduate School of Journalism, and he teaches here at NYU as well. Stephen Solomon is Marjorie Dean Professor of Journalism and Associate Director of NYU's Arthur L. Carter Journalism Institute, where he teaches First Amendment law. His book, which you've heard about, is Revolutionary Dissent, How the Founding Generation Created the Freedom of Speech, is on sale here this evening, published last April. Another of his books is Ellery's Protest, and that tells the story of the controversial Supreme Court case that outlawed state-sponsored Bible reading and prayers in the public schools as a violation of the First Amendment. Thomas Healy is professor of law at Seton Hall University School of Law. He writes about freedom of speech, the methods of the judicial decision-making, and the role of the courts in a democracy. His book, The Great Dissent, How Oliver Wendell Holmes Changed His Mind and Changed the History of Free Speech in America, won the 2014 Robert F. Kennedy Book Award. the Hugh M. Hefner First Amendment Award, and the New Jersey Council for the Humanities Book Award. He is currently at work on a new book about the civil rights movement, for which he received a Guggenheim Fellowship and a public scholar grant from the National Endowment for the Humanities. Without further ado, I will turn things over to Steve. Steve, it's to you.
Gwenda, thank you very much, and thanks to everybody for coming out this evening. It's actually too bad we have to have an event like this, isn't it? Threats to freedom of expression. But here we are in February of 2017 and with a lot to talk about. I think the way we're going to proceed is I'm going to ask each member of the panel to say a few words about what they think is the most serious threat to freedom of expression facing us now. And then when we're done those opening statements, we'll try to look at each one of those points one by one and then turn it over to all of you for questions. So that's how we'll proceed. So I think I'm going to ask George Freeman first to say a few words.
Sure. Thank you, Steve. And thanks for inviting me. And I'm sorry that Nadine's not here. You'd find her far more engaging than I am. But I'll do the best I can to pinch hit. Let me answer your question by starting with two items that I would be the least concerned with. One is Mr. Trump's statement that he wanted to open up the libel laws for numerous reasons. One, that the president can't change the laws. Two, that when he's actually asked what he means, he says he thinks that public officials and public figures should be able to recover where intentional lies are told about him. And that's what the law is anyhow. So the notion that he wants to change it just bespeaks his ignorance as to what the law is. And thirdly, he should be careful what he wishes for, because really he's more likely to be a libel defendant that needs these defenses than a libel plaintiff. So I'm not too worried about that. The second part that I wouldn't get too involved in is FOIA. I mean, every president essentially speaks about open government and does everything it can to restrict the flow of information, the flow of documents from government to the press. So I don't think Donald Trump will be any different. And I don't really put much stock in FOIA because it just takes too long to get anything, even if you get past all the loopholes and all the delays. What I am worried about, on the other hand, is, and I think it's come to fruition already in the first month of the administration, is the possibility of investigations and prosecutions dealing with government leaks. And the administration simply investigates and perhaps prosecutes sources, leakers, government employees, that's bad enough. But the Obama administration, after all, did that more often than any other administration before it. What worries me, I don't think it'll happen, but is worth paying a lot of attention to, is whether this administration will go one step beyond that and actually prosecute the recipients of the leaks, i.e. the journalists. That's never been done before. That would be precedent breaking, and that would really dry up information at an astounding rate and obviously jeopardize the press. So to me, the possibility that he's going to take out after leaks, not only by going after the leakers and not only by subpoenaing the reporters as to who the leakers might be, but after all, also possibly prosecuting the recipients, the press, for publishing that information, that would be downright scary. The other area I'm paying attention to is kind of access to the White House. You know, he obviously has reporters and publications and broadcast networks he thinks are unfavorable to him. And the question is how much he's going to retaliate against them. Will he keep them out of the White House altogether? Will he block the entire press from covering events that historically they have been allowed to cover? We haven't seen much evidence of those sort of things so far. He calls on his favorites at press conferences, but that's not an issue one can do much about. But it'd be interesting to see if he actually goes after either the entire press or members of the press in terms of actually getting access to the White House or to press conferences and so on. I mean, I think that said, the biggest danger is really not legal, but is in terms of his just constant impugning of the press to try to delegitimize it, to try to ruin its credibility. and the toll that that's going to take over time. And it seems to me that has to be met by a fairly concerted PR campaign of some sort. Anyhow, that's my hopefully brief answer.
Thank you, George. Thomas Healy?
Thank you. Thanks for having me here. I think George is absolutely right about what not to be concerned about and what to be concerned about. And I think he's hit a lot of the major points. You could divide up the ways in which government might try to undermine freedom of speech by categorizing them in this way. One is to restrict the flow of information. And I think George has identified ways in which a Trump administration could do that by prosecuting leaks and prosecuting journalists who are the recipients of leaks and by freezing out select media outlets. So stopping the flow of information is one way. Another way is to sort of directly censor or prohibit speech. And so, you know, quote unquote, opening up the libel laws would be a way to accomplish that. And I think George has explained why that's unlikely to happen. And I think a third way to undermine freedom of speech is through one's attitude toward freedom of speech and toward the role that the press plays. And I think George is absolutely right that at least to this point, that's the thing that we have seen most clearly when it comes to Trump. You know, it's really too early for us to see how the other threats will play out, whether he will indeed go after leakers and journalists, whether he'll continue to freeze out media, whether he'll attempt to actually punish people for what they say or punish the media. But we have really good evidence already about Trump's attitude toward freedom of speech and his attitude toward the media. First of all, we see his ignorance of freedom of speech and how the law works. And I think that's certainly not comforting, the fact that he doesn't even make the most basic effort to try to understand what freedom of speech means in this country or what our tradition is, I think is worrisome. And his attempts to delegitimize the press, I think, are even more troubling. The press historically has played in our democracy a checking function or a checking role on the government. And when you delegitimize the media, and when you suggest that the media is just propagating fake news, even the most respected and professional media outlets, then you are attempting to take away the ability of those media outlets to fulfill their role in our constitutional democracy. And I think that Trump has been very clear that that's what he plans to do. And then I think the other aspect of his attitude that toward freedom of speech that's troubling is the disregard, we might even call it contempt, for facts and the construction of an alternate reality. And I think this, and the suggestion that there is sort of no, or the implication that there's no objectively determinable truth, not even to the most banal matters, you know, and easily verifiable matters like electoral vote counts or crowd sizes. And I think that what this attempts to do, or the effect that it has, is to undermine one of the basic assumptions of free speech, which, and of the marketplace of ideas, which is that there are some things, some truths that can be objectively determined. If there is no objective truth, not even, you know, with respect to the most basic, banal things, then I think speech loses its power and its relevance. And I think you see Trump doing this, and the commitment is really pretty awe-inspiring. He won't let a single thing go And he contests everything. And I think that, you know, that's a sort of a deliberate strategy. I was reading earlier today a book by Tim Wu called The Attention Merchants. And one of the chapters deals with propaganda, and it deals with Nazi propaganda in particular. And I don't want to be alarmist or hysterical, but one of the strategies behind Nazi propaganda was sort of to make it absolutely comprehensive, that you had to create an entire reality and an entire truth that you had to be committed to, because to show even one crack of doubt or to admit that your opposition had any sort of truth on their side was to sort of threaten the whole edifice that you had been building. And I think that this is what Trump is doing. And I think that's why he fights every single thing. And you wonder, why is he arguing about this? Why is he insisting on something being true when all of us can see with our eyes that it's false? I think it's because the larger project, and I'm not ascribing any great sort of strategic brilliance to him here, but the larger project is to make us all doubt that there's any truth that we can ever be certain of. And therefore, you know, when he does things that we find objectionable, we'll have no sort of foothold from which to critique what he's doing.
Thank you, Thomas. Floyd?
I agree with so much of what has been said that I feel as if it wasn't fair for me to speak third, having asked for it. I thought I was going to come in here and say, let's put aside the law, let's just talk about the impact of President Trump seeking to delegitimize the press and the harm that may already have done to some extent and is going to continue to do. But that's been said really very, very well by my colleague. So I thought I'd take the liberty then of going back a little bit in American history. You know, it's sometimes people don't recall whenever they learned this, but when the Constitution was adopted in Philadelphia, there was no Bill of Rights. And the states voted not to have a Bill of Rights when they left Philadelphia. It was with a written constitution, but no Bill of Rights. And it was only in the ratification period that either opponents of the Constitution or people who were in favor of it, but deeply troubled by the absence of a Bill of Rights, came to the fore, led by Thomas Jefferson in Paris then, but Jefferson indicating to his close friend Madison, chief draftsman of the Constitution, that it would be very hard for him to support ratification if there were no Bill of Rights, and that a Bill of Rights was something that every free country must have as a way to protect itself. And I think about that in terms of sort of asking myself the question, suppose Hamilton had carried the day back then, Hamilton writing in the Federalist Papers, there's no need to have a Bill of Rights. The government we are reestablishing as it were, from the Articles of Confederation, that government is one of delegated powers. No one said Congress could limit the press. No one said Congress could deprive people of freedom of religion. Why do we have to say it, Hamilton wrote in Federalist 84. And if we say it, he said, we're going to forget things. We're going to argue about what goes into a list of the great rights, et cetera, et cetera. We don't need any of this, Hamilton wrote. And there were a lot of supporters for that. But they lost that battle for a lot of reasons. They lost that battle. And as a result, we wound up with a written Bill of Rights, which are law. not a political essay, but legal principles, enforceable law by judges, as President Trump may be learning a little bit from his problems in the last few weeks. And I'm struck by how different we are. And this is in good part what my book is about. Maybe that's why it's on my mind. But how different we are than other democratic countries in that respect. Just cite two cases to you. In Belgium, a member of parliament was convicted in 2009 for distributing leaflets calling for a Belgian and European first, quote unquote, policy, and for saying, quote, send non-Europeans home, stand up against the Islamification of Belgium. And in England, just last year, someone was convicted for carrying around a sign with a picture of the World Trade Center ablaze and saying, Islam out of Britain, protect the British people. Now, that's one way of saying that Donald Trump himself would have committed a crime throughout Europe. It would be criminal to say what he did about Muslims, about Mexicans, and about others in the campaign. But that's not my point. My point is that we protect that, and we pay a price for that. We protect hate speech, which is not just uncomfortable, but sometimes debilitating and worse. And the time when I think we see the benefits of our protecting hate speech, the benefits of having less in the way of libel limitations, less in the way of privacy limitations on free speech, and less protection even in the foreign policy national defense area as against broad sweeping free speech principles. The time when I think we recognize the advantages of our system most is when we think we have most to be concerned about. And that time may be now. The First Amendment, as it was read to you, think of it, starts at Congress shall make no law. And after dealing with religion, it says abridging the freedom of speech or of the press. As initially drafted by Madison, it wasn't Congress shall make no law. It was basically the public shall be entitled to free speech. But by making it deliberately negative, by making it a limitation on government, what they did back then was to establish very clearly that the core of the First Amendment, the core of the Bill of Rights in general, is a protection against government. That was what they were afraid of, the government coming too close, touching on, impairing freedom of religion, of the press, of speech, of assembly. And it's now when, you know, there is reason for concern. I share with the view of my colleagues. We're not going to have new libel law. The president doesn't even know there is no federal libel law. We have 50 states. That there is no United States libel law for him to amend, because that's all state law, which is then governed by the U.S. Constitution and limited by the Constitution. So it's now, I think, at a time when, you know, we have reason for concern, albeit generalized concern, on a who knows what's going to happen next basis. You know, where we have a president who says that, you know, that the press is the enemy of the American people. I mean, this is language, which is very familiar to people who have been oppressed, and the word is not unfair, around the world for many years by many authoritarian figures, and a number of other things that he said. So we don't know if this is all just going to be talk, and even if it is, as my two colleagues have said, the talk is talk which is very threatening to free expression by diminishing the power, the relationship of the press to the public. But whatever happens, the idea that we have a First Amendment, that it is law, that it is enforceable as law by independent judges, ought to give us at least a significant degree of comfort as we wait to see what comes out of Washington.
Thank you, Floyd. I'd like to add a few thoughts of my own. You talked about the battle over the Bill of Rights back 200 years ago. There's a remarkable exchange of letters between James Madison and Thomas Jefferson over exactly that. And one of the things that Madison said was, of course he was in favor of rights, but he thought a Bill of Rights was no more than parchment protections, like pieces of paper that would blow away in a stiff breeze. It wasn't really worth that much. And Jefferson wrote back, memorably, saying that the citizens of all countries have the right to be protected, and having a Bill of Rights would place safeguards in the hands of the judiciary. And that was a very wise thing that he said, because as a matter of fact, over the past 50 or 60 years, I think we have to be quite satisfied with the job that the federal judiciary has done, the Supreme Court, in protecting not only individual rights and liberties in general, but certainly the freedom of the press and the freedom of speech. But I don't think that it's wise to depend so much on the judiciary. I think Madison had an idea there about these parchment barriers. I think what he was really getting at was, unless you agree, unless the people themselves agree that freedom of expression is a fundamental value, that it defines ourselves as a people, then it's always at risk. And that it takes more than the judiciary, it takes a consensus in the population. And that's what worries me a bit. My colleagues have mentioned how the press in many ways has been delegitimized. And there's millions of people in this country who don't trust the press, think the press puts out, establishment press puts out false news and enemies of the people and so forth. But there are also millions of people in this country, and I think we've seen this to a large extent on college campuses especially, students and others who, many of whom feel that certain speakers shouldn't be allowed on college campuses because their views may upset them. There should be safe spaces and so forth. And I think that these things coming together, the attacks on the press, the attempts to delegitimize it, and melting away of some of the vigor of protecting the press and the feeling that freedom of expression is so important, I think that goes back to Madison's worry that if you don't have a general consensus in society, these may be parchment barriers in some ways. And so that's a broader concern than some of the very specific things that the Trump administration can do. But if we don't, as citizens, feel that freedom of expression is a fundamental value that defines us as a people, then we may be in more trouble than we think. So I want to go back to George, who talked, raised some issues about prosecutions and attempts to get information from reporters. And I thought I would ask him, in terms of the press, I mean, we understand that the administration could go after leakers in the government. And Trump has already said or referred that matter over to the Justice Department to look into it. In order to find out who the leakers are, you have to talk to the journalists, presumably, I mean, unless you're tapping phones and stuff. So if you're calling journalists in to testify, you're issuing subpoenas, and they're done by grand juries, The press doesn't have much in the way of protection, and the Supreme Court ruled something like 45 years ago, and not very clearly, that the First Amendment really didn't give very much protection. So I was wondering, George, what are the prospects here?
Well, the interesting thing is that there's good news and bad news. The good news is that there are going to be, I think, less subpoenas on the press in the coming years. And that's good if you're representing reporters who won't be then subpoenaed. The bad news is that the reason for that is that government can figure out who the leakers are themselves. They don't need the help of reporters anymore the way they used to, because by technology, by emails, by phone records, they can often, and they have often, figured it out without having to subpoena the press. And the problem is that while that's good for the media lawyers in terms of not having to defend very difficult cases, it's bad because it effectively chills information. And so the result is as bad as it, if not worse. So I think we will see actually fewer subpoenas on the press, but perhaps more prosecutions of leakers, and government itself will figure out who the leakers are and therefore be able to go against them directly. I mean, the one point I'd make, Stephen, is that legally there's a huge difference between going against a government employee who leaks unauthorized information, which they're not supposed to do. Daniel Ellsberg would have clearly been convicted of the crime of the Espionage Act violation of leaking classified sensitive documents to the Times, but for the fact that in a forerunner of Watergate, the prosecution broke into his shrink's office to get dirt on him and also offered the trial judge the job of director of the FBI when J. Edgar Hoover died or retired. And so the judge threw the case out for prosecutorial misconduct. But otherwise, he would have been dead to rights. On the other hand, to go against the media for publishing material which they passively receive, they don't do anything illegal themselves, you basically have to be able to show that the material was either not newsworthy, not truthful, or that the newspaper did do something and the press did do something illegal. And in most cases, you can't show that. So in most cases, there's going to be a pretty good argument by the press to defend itself, even if they knew that the material they were getting, they shouldn't be getting, was illegally given to them by the leaker. So there's a big distinction between the leaker and the recipient of the leak, and we wait to see whether that distinction will be respected by the administration or whether they'll break precedent and go after the press anyhow. In the warrantless wiretap case about 10 years ago when the Times ran stories that the Bush administration didn't like about their unconstitutional wiretapping, Bush, Cheney, and Rumsfeld all went on TV within a day or two of the Times article and said we should go prosecute the Times. In the Pentagon Papers, four Supreme Court justices said, well, there's not enough here for a prior restraint, but we suggest the Times be prosecuted. In neither case did any prosecution even begin. In the first case, I think the U.S. attorney said, I didn't want to lose the case, and to bring a case against the Times in New York during the Vietnam War was a loser, so I wasn't going to do it. And I think in the other case, we don't know why the government didn't do what Bush and Cheney said they were going to do. But my guess is that to play in the arena where they were doing something unconstitutional wasn't going to be politically the wisest thing. But it also goes to what Steve said, which is that I think that in the end, even though public opinion about the media is very low, the notion of government suing a newspaper, suing a broadcast station for publication of truthful and newsworthy facts is something the public just is, it's not part of our culture, and I'm not sure the public really wants or is used to. And that's why what you said is so important, that the value of a free press has to remain, and we can't let propaganda kind of change that, or else I think we're all lost. And our biggest bulwark, as I think a couple of you have said, I think really is the judiciary, and that's why the administration is going against the judiciary as much as it's going against the media. We're really the two checks on the executive, and not surprisingly, those are the two institutions that the president is going after the most.
No, my question was just, George, if you're suggesting that the administration can easily determine who the leakers are. Why are there? Why is it leaking like a, you know, like a sinking ship? I mean, they're just, the number of leaks seems completely unprecedented. Do you think at this point it's just incompetence? And at a certain point, the administration will be competent enough to control the leaks and to go after the people who are leaking?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know the answer, but my hunch is that a lot of the people in these positions haven't been appointed in the first 40 days by this president. So who, you know, they're not loyal to him, and therefore leaks are more viable.
I'd add, I have a word for the recent spate of leakers, and that's patriots. I think whoever they are, wherever they are, they're deeply concerned about what they perceive to be dangers to the country and are willing to take great personal risks, which I think they understand. Now, that assumes that the recent information comes from, or even in good part, comes, as the president believes, from people in the intelligence services here. That need not be true. They could be foreign intelligence services. There are a lot of other places now that the information can be found. And one of the newer things also that's happened since, say, the Pentagon Papers, 7,000 pages, top secret, the biggest leak in American history as of that time, 4,000 pages of analysis how the U.S. got into the war in Vietnam, 3,000 basically of New York Times issues and other newspapers and the like. Now we talk about millions of pages. Snowden alone had access to, no one really knows how many pages where and when and to whom the material he had wound up. But taking what he says at face values, you're still talking about over a million pages. Just one person having access to all that. And a number of things change when you talk in that sort of situation. One of the things that changes is that more gets out, more is leaked. It's easier to get things out. It's easier to be anonymous. And again, remember, it doesn't have to be within this country. Assange is not here. And he is, in my view, the least responsible of individuals and whose organization has been obtaining sometimes highly classified material. Never as highly classified as Snowden had, but still some serious materials. And in the old days, journalists had to make really hard decisions, and they struggled, they really did, about, at the Pentagon Papers, which was, after all, just a history of how the U.S. got into the war in Vietnam. But nonetheless, the people on the Times really had wrenching decisions to make about top-secret documents, which the government said would irreparably damage the country and its people, with American POWs being held by the Vietnamese and the like, and the government saying it would make it harder to free them. I mean, it was a big-time decision. Now, once a WikiLeaks gets hundreds of thousands of documents, it's already sort of out there. I mean, the sort of anguished, and it really was, the anguished decision-making about shall we release this or that, and the Times took 3 months back in those days talking to experts from the state, former CIA, former State Department, et cetera, and would this really harm national security? Now it's sort of become an easier decision because it's often a non-decision, because if you don't publish it, someone else will. That's not an argument for publishing, but it is a way of saying that we are going to be less and less successful in keeping secrets, even real secrets, even secrets that can do harm to to national security. And that just comes with the new technological age in which we live.
So with the threats that we've been talking about, when you think about the New York Times and the Washington Post, the Wall Street Journal, and some of the large news organizations like that, you can well imagine that they can kind of take care of themselves. Even in this difficult time for journalism, they have the resources to defend themselves and to go ahead with the kind of enterprise journalism that makes a difference because they investigate. I wonder if the panelists could talk about the potential chilling effect, possibly on some large news organizations, but certainly on smaller publications, small magazines, smaller newspapers around the country, and certainly on the large number of freelancers we have today who do all kinds of articles, may be doing investigations, and don't have the resources to defend themselves, whether it's from a subpoena that comes from the Justice Department or a lawsuit of one kind or another. Is this a real worry about the chilling effect that they won't do the necessary work because they won't have the backing, the financial backing to defend themselves? Anybody?
I would just say that I don't think it impacts national security reporting because, you know, the blogger in Wichita is not going to have sources, is not going to have information of a national security level that really is going to make an impact or really would be a story that would break news. I think that would be extremely unlikely. I mean, Times reporters who get these stories have worked and, you know, dredged in these fields for years before they get the leaks, before they get this sort of information. But I think the point you're making bears very strongly on local reporting, on corruption of the city council, on corporate misdoings in your local town. And there, if the local paper doesn't have the money to fund long investigative pieces or is afraid to get into sensitive areas because of fear of having to pay lawyers a lot of money, that is certainly a very, very grave problem that we face and that I think we do face because given the financial problems that the media is having, those stories are, I don't want to say disappearing, but becoming scarcer.
I agree. Steve and I were discussing this last week, and he asked me, he said, would you be hesitant to undertake writing a biography of Donald Trump right now? And I said, sure, I'd be hesitant. If you have a publisher, then maybe the publisher's legal team will defend you, and maybe there's something in your contract where you'll be indemnified. But, you know, given the choice between writing a biography of Donald Trump and writing a biography of someone who you don't have to worry about, coming after you with a lawsuit, you would certainly choose the other person. Just posing that question to me sort of, you know, I think made me realize that there certainly is a chilling effect. And it's, you know, it's, you're probably right. I think I had the same response that George did, that most of the kind of national security reporting is going to come from places like the Times and the Post that probably still have the resources to defend themselves. But there's, you know, there is the possibility of freelancers, generating serious news. A lot of, you know, former national security reporters, they leave places like the Times or the Post to write books or to write on a freelance basis. And I think they could certainly be chilled, could be concerned about a lawsuit, about sort of being, you know, called out in a tweet in the middle of the night. In some weird way, a publicly traded company is in the worst position. Because, you know, one tweet and all of a sudden your stock prices can plummet. At least a small family-owned newspaper doesn't have to worry about their stock price.
Well, there's another thing that there was an article written by an acquaintance of mine about Trump's lawsuits, libel lawsuits that he's brought. And there are two instructive parts about it. One is that he's 0-7. He lost every libel suit that he brought. But there are quotes from him in the article that he says, I'm happy with the outcome because I made them spend a lot of money. So basically, he's using the legal system to drain his opponents. Now, that's why slap laws exist, but slap laws don't always take care of this problem. The second part that goes to, Tom, your answer as a potential publisher of a story about Trump is that the story that depicted the seven lawsuits, which was a serious legal analysis, it was written for an ABA magazine, and the ABA censored the article. It didn't allow the article to run because they were afraid of A, being looking partisan, and B, afraid of a lawsuit from Trump. And there was some irony with the ABA, the lawyers' organization, censoring the First Amendment Committee of the ABA from publishing an article that shows a presidential candidate's libel history. I should say immodestly that our organization jumped into the breach and we published it because I didn't see there was a legal problem, really. But this is a guy who, when he was suing because a book said that his net worth was only $250 million, not $2 billion. And when asked, well, what is your net worth? His answer was, under oath, well, it depends on the kind of mood I wake up with in the morning. So that's the kind of litigant we have.
Can I just add that, sweeping beyond Trump for a minute, one of the most disturbing developments, I think, in the last few years was in the Gawker case, the Hulk Hogan case, where another, but much less well-known, multi-billionaire financed the case from beginning to end and basically put Gawker out of business, bankrupted it. I mean, that had, so far as I know, had really never happened before. And the notion, and remember, this is Peter Thiel, and he wasn't even in the case. It wasn't as if he was suing. He just liked the idea because he thought Gawker had been very unfair to him in its coverage of his sexual orientation, that he just financed the case for the purpose of putting this publication out of business and succeeded in doing so. And that is a very, very troubling potential precedent. And it is troubling even as to our great newspapers who are dedicated to journalism, and even more so to less financed, less serious entities. And when you leave sort of old newspapers behind and you talk about what an individual blogger, uninsured, unadvised by counsel, in the wild west world of the internet, who can be bankrupt like that by someone like Mr. Thiel.
Let me ask some very specific questions about what the Trump administration could do and whether they would be on firm legal footing. Okay, so example number one, I'm looking out at all of you. Let's say this is a presidential press conference. And we know that Mr. Trump is not particularly fond of certain news organizations and in fact has excluded them in some cases from campaign events. Of course, now he's president. Suppose he says CNN, can't be here. New York Times, see you later. Pick your news organization that he doesn't like. Can he do that?
Well, I think that's a winning lawsuit. There are some cases, not a whole lot, and never in the U.S. Supreme Court, where the press has been excluded from a public event, usually in a public place, which deals with another issue. And I think if he were to do it, and if he were going to do it, he would probably do it in the way that is least defensible legally. And so, yeah, I mean, it is conceivable. I mean, you know, it's not kidding to say Yes, he could save some time to, I mean, he's capable, and his people, I believe, capable of saying, you know, CNN can't sit in this room. We have 47 chairs. We have none for you. And that, I think, would be a successful lawsuit.
I think, though, I mean, he could not have press conferences at all. I think the question probably could be answered that it would be a bad lawsuit if it had to do with, you know, going with him on a plane or to dinner or God knows where. But a presidential press conference, if there's retaliation because of alleged unfavorable coverage, that's about the strongest case of that type that the press
and
would
of course
have.
There's no lawsuit if he just doesn't call on CNN.
And right, exactly, which is seems to be what is current plan is.
Well, he could also, I think, tell me if I'm wrong, he has the press, he doesn't do the press conferences, as you said, and he just invites groups of reporters into his office for conversations, and you can only have five or six at a time, and he just never gets around to inviting those who disagree with him. Yeah. Is that any problem with that?
I think that would be a very difficult position, very difficult lawsuit for the press.
Yeah, but he would never say that I didn't get around to it. Just that suggests he made a mistake. What he would say is, they'll never darken my doorstep.
But still, it's a weak lawsuit, even if he said that, I think.
Well, which brings us back to the point of his goal is not so much to stop the press from speaking as to dominate the press. To delegitimize the press, to make it clear who's in charge. And that's why he wouldn't be subtle enough to exclude a media outlet from press conferences without making clear that he was punishing them for the views that they were expressing. I mean, the backdrop to the question has to do with whether the press has any, or whether the public has any First Amendment right to access information from the government, and there are some rights to access, for instance, access to criminal trials, but the administration doesn't have to hold press conferences. There's no right for the press to go in and question the president, and so the administration's argument would be, we don't have to hold this press conference to begin with, therefore no one has a right to be invited. And so I think that the basis for the challenge would have to be that you excluded us based upon the views that we were expressing. And viewpoint discrimination or content discrimination is the most sort of offensive form of violation of the First Amendment. The Supreme Court is pretty sensitive to that. And I think that's, especially if he made clear that he was doing it on those grounds, which I think, as Floyd says, he would, then there would be a decent challenge.
You know, one of the great observations of Justice Potter Stewart, a very, very protective jurist on the court with respect to the First Amendment, was that the First Amendment is not an Official Secrets Act or a Freedom of Information Act, that it's neither, that the First Amendment, in his view, doesn't guarantee that you get information and doesn't punish you if you publish bad information. It just sets the ground lines. It just sets the rules of the game, so to speak, which is that basically an anti-censorial one. The government can't censor speech. The government can't, in general, can't punish you for speech is the sort of starting point of the First Amendment about free speech and free press. But that if the president said, I'm not going to hold press conferences, there's no First Amendment requirement of holding press conferences. Now, if the president said, I'm not going to have any Muslims at my press conference, that's a terrible thing, but a great lawsuit. And if he were to if he were to say, I'm not going to have CNN because I think it is the worst news organization in the world, there could be a lawsuit, it's difficult. It would be difficult. It is conceivable that, particularly if he continues to attack the judiciary, that some judge would find a way to rule against him.
So one more question, and then we'll open it up. I think we assume that a lot of these things happen to the print media or the internet, where there's a great deal of case law that protects those mediums of communication. But we may be forgetting that there's one medium of communication that is subject to licensing. And that's, of course, the broadcasting industry through the FCC. And if I'm correct, I think stations come up for renewal, what, every 3 years or so? Certainly, they would not be so bald as to say, we're not going to renew your license because we don't like what you're saying on the air. But if there were multiple challenges from, let's say, conservative groups, who want to take over that part of the spectrum in that community, might there be some real possibility that in a underhanded way, the press could be punished through the licensing process?
That's one of the things President Nixon tried to do, is to at least threaten broadcasters having the spokesperson of the FCC make certain statements of a very threatening nature about license renewal. It was one of the things that the Washington Post was told and the New York Times was told, or the New York Times, in any event, was told by its lawyers. Fortunately, I would say their former lawyers, but told by their lawyers, you'll lose your broadcast licenses if you publish the Pentagon Papers. So, I mean, that the lawyers would think like that. And President Nixon tried in different ways, three different branches of government to put pressure. The Internal Revenue Service, the Antitrust Division of the Department of Justice, and the FCC. And all of those can lead to, at the least, enormous concern, especially, as you say, the publicly owned company, and enormous concern by entities that don't have the sort of money that can fight the government on a continuing principled basis.
So, questions? Nico.
Nat Hentoff recently died, and he often argued against libel laws in their entirety. So I wanted to put it to you whether or not it's a good idea to close up the libel laws and whether they have done more harm than good in the United States.
Do you mean to not have any cause of action for defamation? I mean, I think there are interests on the other side. I mean, I think people do have an interest in their reputation and protecting their reputation. In particular, private individuals who, are not a part of the operation of the government or are not public figures, so that they have sort of large influence over the affairs of society. I mean. I think, one of the things, even if you're a lover of the First Amendment and of free speech, I think it's important to recognize that it's not the only important value in our democracy. There are other important values, such as privacy, such as your personal reputation, such as equality. And these values often conflict with free speech. And often, we decide that the free speech values trump, or we draw the line in such a way that we accommodate the other values along with free speech. And I think that's what the Supreme Court has done when it comes to defamation. It's easier for a private individual to sue for defamation than it is for a public official or a public figure. And I think that's the correct place to draw the line. One could draw it differently. One could make it easier for public figures who are not elected to government to sue. But the Supreme Court has chosen to treat public figures largely the same as public officials, and I think that's an acceptable place to draw the line. But I wouldn't be in favor of doing away with defamation as a cause of action in the service of greater free speech, because I think that would be sacrificing sort of needlessly another important value.
But would you, congressmen have a absolute privilege under the Constitution to say what they want on the floor of the House or Senate without fear of being sued for what they say. Yet the people who elect them don't have any such privilege. I think there's a good case to be made that at least in terms of speech involving a assessment of the performance of public officials, that there's a good case to be made that the people should have the same right that the representatives have, which is a complete and an absolute privilege against libel suits. Public officials, not necessarily private persons.
So you would argue that an intentional lie about a congressperson should not be actionable in a defamation suit?
Well, it seems like public officials are making intentional lies against citizens and are privileged to do so.
Well, against citizens or against other public officials in a debate about a public policy?
I'm delighted to have the argument be about this sort of issue. I do agree with Tom that I think there's a real place for libel law, and I think historically there's really not much of an argument if one wants to try an originalist view of this, that anyone, Jefferson included, and indeed Jefferson in particular, who really thought that by adopting the First Amendment that they would be getting rid of libel law completely. So I do want to say Nat Hentoff was one of the great First Amendment defenders ever. And we miss him terribly in that respect. And Justice Black, who had views on the Supreme Court as close to Nat as anyone who's ever sat on the court, was of the view that no law means no law. Congress, you remember the words? Congress shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech or of the press. Now, what do lawyers or historians get into? They get into, what does the mean? The Congress shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech. There are a lot of scholars, very serious people, who read the word "the" to mean the freedom of speech as it was back at the time it was adopted, or the freedom of speech as a whole. You know, a system of free expression. But Justice Black did take the position that no law meant no law, and very dramatic moment in the argument in the Pentagon Papers case. The counsel for the United States said to Justice Black, your position is well known, Mr. Justice, that you think no law means no law. Now, that's the worst way, of course, to make an argument, right? Right? I mean, how can you, that is the way Justice Black would like the argument put. No law means no law. But we really have lived the entirety of our country under a regime which includes libel law, and I think it really does serve a significant public service. Indeed, I made an argument to a media group a few months ago that depending what happened in the months and years to come, that they might consider bringing libel suits if the president or other people said things about them which were knowingly untrue, that the press itself, notwithstanding its the protective shield that the First Amendment has been held to provide it against most libel cases, but that journalists too ought to at least bear in mind that they're not completely defenseless if someone in the government, to be sure, not on the floor of Congress, but says something about them that isn't true and that meets the standards for libel. In our case, in this hypothetical, false material, defamatory material, known to be false about the person that you're talking about and harming the person. That came as a surprise to a lot of journalists in the room and lawyers, who spend their life defending journalists and defending free speech. But in any event, I agree that there's a place for libel law, and it won't come up in real life.
Thank you so much. Considering the people's right to know, which is some consideration, would you gentlemen discuss the justification for secrecy at all in what ought to be a democracy, and considering the wars and complications that we get into, the people need to know. Would you discuss this, please? Justification for secrecy.
All right. You can see it's a hard question. This is the three tenors here looking at each other. The system is rooted in good part on precisely what you say, at least we say it is, on the public's right to know. Does that mean, and should it mean, the right to know everything about what the government is doing or saying? I do think that there are genuine and appropriate secrets in the military area and the diplomatic area. I'll give you an example of where I personally have been critical of Edward Snowden, and that is when he revealed amongst the documents that he made available, not dealing with domestic surveillance in this country, but to take just one modest example, that the United States and Norway and Sweden had a secret agreement to engage in surveillance over Russia and to share information about what's going on there, both literally on the ground, in their military, and their political and the like, political mechanisms and the like. No one has suggested there was any wrongdoing in that, but it was secret. It was secret because perhaps the Russians wouldn't find out. They probably would, but you don't know. There are certain things in the military diplomatic area which just can't be done if they have to be fully exposed. That was one of them. I mean, that's not a deep secret. I'm sure no one got hurt as a result of the revelation, but as to whether it should have been revealed, whether it's part of the public's right to know, I didn't think so.
I think one of the questions that your question raises is what should happen if government employees identify wrongdoing in the government, and if the information that they have is classified or protected in some way from being disclosed. And you know, Edward Snowden would certainly be prosecuted if he returned to this country. And yet I think a lot of us feel as though much of what he revealed did a great public service. So the question then becomes, how can you both keep the secrets that need to be kept for purposes of national security, but provide ways for government employees to expose things that the government is doing that it shouldn't be doing? And I think that's where sort of strong protections for whistleblowers comes into play. I think, you know, it's probably not ideal. You know, you would like it if someone who sees something, some sort of wrongdoing in the government, could simply go straight to the media and report that. But given the need to protect national security, I think a system that enables those individuals to report what they see to someone and ensures that they won't be retaliated and ensures that that will be followed up on is probably the best that we can hope for.
The technology has a interesting impact here. The you'll go back to the Pentagon Papers case. Daniel Ellsberg famously ran off 7,000 pages of government documents and gave it to the New York Times and the Washington Post, which put together teams of reporters spending weeks or months looking it over and writing news stories, a series of news stories, and they could had the opportunity to take out names of people who might be at risk. They had the opportunity to take out other material that they thought was really critical to perhaps to national security. And so what they published, in their judgment at least, was something that was important to the American people but did not go over whatever line they thought was there. Daniel Ellsberg did not have a thumb drive. And what we see today is thousands of documents being downloaded and then potentially immediately uploaded to websites without any intermediary seeing them and having an opportunity to say, well, should we really publish those names, those spies out in the field who might then be targeted? I mean, that would be the responsible thing to do, obviously, if you want to publish classified documents. And that's generally not being done. And that raises the stakes quite a bit.
I mean, WikiLeaks, for example, released 250,000 classified documents, all the cables that went in and out of Washington for a certain particular amount of time, a number of which contained the names of human rights workers to whom American ambassadors around the world had promised confidentiality. That sort of disclosure of materials, some of which has to or ought to be kept secret, you know, is very, very troubling. Similarly, WikiLeaks released the entirety of the files from Sony that were hacked, including social security numbers of employees of Sony that had nothing to do with anything except that their name and information about them was contained in files that were hacked and then ultimately made public.
Yeah, this relates to the same question. I'm sort of concerned about democracy. And what I recall is that in 1982, I happened to be with the analysts of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. And we were in the middle of the Cold War, Russia being the enemy. And I asked them, do we monitor their information? And the fellow said, them, they're not our enemy. What we do is we share our information with them. We're concerned with a place like Indonesia developing an atom bomb. And so what I'm concerned about is that we live in a fictional world in which the NSA knows something, journalists and lawyers know something, and nobody in this country knows the same thing. And so I would like to know how we ever operate as a democracy.
I think that's one for you.
Was it a question or a statement?
No, yeah. I'd like to know an answer to that. You know, how do I ever find out? It feels like a Rubik's Cube and a number of other things. Yes.
I'm afraid I'm not going to have a satisfying answer to the question. I think it's a good question. I certainly, you know, I don't think anyone up here thinks that.
You're talking about collective political consciousness, as in Sigmund Freud, you know?
I think it's vital that the people in the democracy have information about what their government's doing. I think the only point that Floyd and I were making is that at least we think that there are some areas in which secrets might be called for in order to protect national security. But as to whether or not there's sort of a whole host of information that journalists and government officials and certain lawyers have access to that other people don't have access to.
Whether they ever have the same information, that's what I'm asking. Whether anyone ever has the same.
Oh, because of fragmentation of media and polarization.
I think that's a very fair point, and I think that I think you put it very, very fairly in terms of, you know, small circles of people having information, having a reality level information in circumstances in which the public, sometimes in good faith, sometimes bad, but often good or bad, where the public doesn't know what's going on. The Indonesia example is a very good one, I think. That is a reality. I'm just thinking out loud about it. I could see circumstances in which, you know, I would particularly in terms of dangerous nations obtaining atomic weapons, where I wouldn't want full disclosure. On the other hand, what you describe, and which I think is a fair statement about certain situations that have developed, that it's a play world in which everyone agrees, including people on both sides of the divide, that it's better for everybody if no one except us knows what's going on, and that is, I mean, it might even be true sometimes, but by definition, it's very dangerous. And I don't mean just in terms of running a democratic society. It's dangerous because you wind up with cynical, corrupted people, very often having information that no one else has, and that we might not want to have those people being the ones who have it.
I listen to with very great fascination to all these paeans to freedom of speech in the U.S. and to the judiciary, and it's not my experience at all. Presumably we have marketplace of ideas, you've mentioned it, and everybody can, you know, make their contribution and sell their point of view there, except for there is, we do not call those people censors, we call them publishers, we call them editors, but censorship is very much present, at least in the book publishing, where unless you have access to the right people, you can't really publish, you cannot make a run around them because the government blocks you. And when you try to sue, I personally discovered there isn't any such thing as due process. The judges basically decide a bogus case that they themselves invent, complete with the argument and with everything. So there isn't really even a way of breaking that wall. And the greatest fascination that I have with it is that the press and the lawyers do not want to hear about it. Privately, many lawyers told me, yeah, of course, it's all a sham. It's about the show of justice. rather than actual justice. And but the press seems to think that they are kind of the kings of the mountain and that the mountain will disappear if everybody is going to be able to speak. And so they are protecting it. They're protecting their own turf. So my question is, I mean, my personal...
They're not doing a very good job these days, by the way.
Well...
Is their influence is diminishing?
Well, in terms of book publishing, certainly. And the government is behind them. And it's impossible to do anything through the courts. And ACLU is not interested in knowing that there is no free speech and that there is no due process. The press isn't interested. And I'm just, you know, you're all saying, oh, you know, there's wonderful judges and this wonderful press. You know, we're living in a country with liberty for some and justice for very, very few. And yet the press just doesn't want to, I talk to journalists and people, you see how they close their ears and they just do not want to hear. And yet every time you open the New York Times, they're saying truth. You know, we care about truth. So how are those two worlds, you know, not willing to know about truth and yet saying we want to know truth? And we're speaking truth. You know, this whole selectivity is kind of amazing.
Well, I think they just don't agree with you on what truth is.
Well, but they're blocking, but the marketplace of ideas is blocked, essentially.
Well, I will grant you that. First of all, the marketplace of ideas is a metaphor. It's not a suggestion that there's a sort of perfectly functioning marketplace. And there are certainly people who have greater access to the marketplace of ideas than others. There's no doubt about that. I think one of the hopes that people had about the internet was that the internet would provide greater access to speak. To people who had previously been denied it. And I think that has happened to a very large extent. I mean, if you think about, you know, 40 or 50 years ago, if you wanted to have a platform to speak, you had to go through an institution. You had to go through a media company or a book publisher. These days, that's not true. You can capture a lot of attention by going around those traditional gatekeepers. And I think that's a real positive development. That's not to say that it's perfect, but it's certainly, I think, easier for people, for ordinary people now, to participate in the marketplace of ideas than it was in the past.
Let's try to have two quick ones. Jessica?
The theme of the panel is threats to free expression, First Amendment. You mentioned the possibility of journalists suing for libel against public officials who libel them. Could you give an example or really follow that through on circumstances in which you think a journalist might consider doing that? Of course, they would have to have serious resources behind them. So I think for everyone in the room who's interested in supporting the media and supporting the First Amendment, what can people here actually do?
I'll address the first part first. I can see circumstances in which a public figure makes charges, makes statements of purported fact, not rhetorical hyperbole, not more general denunciations, not you're the worst this in the world, et cetera, but. You know, you wrote this, and this wasn't true, and that wasn't true, et cetera, et cetera. It has enormously harmful impact, et cetera. There are circumstances in which that could give rise to a libel case. I can't tell you that journalists have brought libel cases, and journalists in general have been taught libel is our poison. I mean, libel is what threatens us, and it historically has. But with the protections that now exist, we have a situation now where I believe it is true to say the New York Times doesn't have a single libel case against it. Time Magazine doesn't have a single libel case against it. That was unthinkable, you know, during my lifetime. when they used to have lawyers within those companies who only worked on their libel cases. Now, that's because of the development of the law in a more and more protective way, which the publications would say is a very good thing, and I think in general is indeed a very good thing. But I could see an effort by even a president or someone in a lower position than a president denouncing in clear, factual, but untrue ways a journalist which gets the person fired and finding a lawyer is not so expensive to represent.
Floyd, that's not our experience. Will you represent this journalist, please?
Well let's talk later.
Okay.
I wonder whether you took any solace in popular culture's response to people such as Trump. In other words, I can reel off right now, in addition to Alec Baldwin and Stephen Colbert and Samantha Bee, and you go through the litany, these people are making very strenuous statements and obviously demeaning the president. Is there any consolation in the free speech realm? I mean, you're worried about Trump, writing a biography of Trump, his biographer. Made remarks that would ordinarily be libelous.
That's why I'm worried.
Well, yes and no, but he's not been sued. And to the extent, in other words, that popular culture is responding in the realm of free speech, I'm not sure, is this purely frivolous or is there some merit to it?
No, I think it's fantastic. It's
then let's consoled at least a little bit.
Of course, yeah, we're consoled. No, I think, I think one saw something similar during the Bush administration. For a lot of us, what kept us sane was watching The Daily Show and the Colbert Report. And you know, their criticism of the administration, I think, was often more thoughtful and more sort of pointed than the criticism that you saw leveled by mainstream media organizations. I think a lot of people are disappointed or feel as though somehow free speech or the media let us down because Trump won the election. And I think you have to be careful. I mean, the First Amendment doesn't guarantee any particular result. And the fact that Trump won doesn't mean that the First Amendment didn't function as it was designed to. It just means that another viewpoint prevailed. I think when another viewpoint prevails, the way to win is to try to make your argument stronger, to make it in different ways. And I think that the satire you see of Trump is one of the ways to accomplish that. Am I wrong, Floyd? Does the First Amendment guarantee certain outcomes?
No, you're right on.
One more quick question.
Was the Hulk Hogan Gawker case a fluke, or is it possible that we'll see other cases where invasion of privacy is kind of used as a way of intimidating the press?
Yeah, the... It's too early to say, because the Hulk Hogan invasion of privacy was a film of people having sex, and that may be by its nature something which judges and juries will view as so private, even for a Hulk Hogan, that it should get a level of protection that almost anything else wouldn't. I also think there's a generational aspect about the Hulk Hogan case that I think younger people would be less outraged by that which was shown. I also think, for what it's worth, it would have been reversed if they'd had enough money to stay in court and appeal the ruling. We talk about money in different ways here this evening, and there's just no avoiding that reality, that it should happen to a publication, whatever one thinks of it, that was, well-known and modestly financed, but nonetheless a player, makes it all the more shocking.
Okay. If I can say one last word, I want to refer to something that Floyd said in another forum. He said that Donald Trump represented the greatest threat to the First Amendment since the Sedition Act of 1798. He said that in November. So a lot has happened since then. And so I thought it might be
interesting. Everything's okay now.
So I thought it might be interesting to go back and look at the Sedition Act of 1798 and actually see what happened. Well, of course, John Adams of the Federalist Party was president. Congress, both houses of Congress were controlled by the Federalists, and they passed this law, fearing an impending war with France, and tried to punish the political opposition, the Jeffersonians, the Democratic Republicans. They managed to put a dozen or so editors into jail. They actually jailed a congressman, Matthew Lyon. And so in some ways that law was successful, but not really, because the people didn't like go down into a hole and wait for the storm to pass. Actually, the opposition intensified. More pamphlets, more articles, more letters all throughout the country. The number of opposition newspapers doubled in the space of 2 years while the Sedition Act was in effect. And so there was this popular outpouring to say that suppression is not acceptable. And I think that goes a little bit to what I opened by saying about the commitment of the American people to the values of freedom of speech, and whether that remains today in the face of potential suppression. We haven't gotten to that point yet, but certainly some major problems. So I think that chapter, of course, is yet to be written, but the fact that so many people came out today to engage in this kind of discussion is certainly a good sign that the values behind freedom of the press and freedom of speech are in good hands. So thank you all.